Actually, Julian right now is straddling, nandun na sa may northwestern boundary ng Philippine Area of Responsibility. It may briefly exit the PAR as it makes it a recurvature. Liliko siya. And then it will then be moving slowly, just like when, you know, we're turning in a curve when we're driving. So babagal muna siya saglit. And then by tomorrow, Wednesday, it will then make its landfall in southwestern Taiwan. The rugged terrain, the mountainous part of Taiwan will weaken the super typhoon and then be downgraded to severe tropical storm and will permanently leave the Philippine Area of Responsibility by Thursday. But Karen, for today, Tuesday, we will still be experiencing some heavy to intense torrential rains over Batanes, Babuyan Islands, and parts of Ilocos Region and Cordillera. So the threat of flooding and landslides remain very, very high, especially in Ilocos Region. Karen?
How would you describe or characterize Super Typhoon Julian? Because Pag-asa said it still has a window for what they say is brief intensification in the next 24 hours.
Yes, so while Julian will be making its turn, liliko siya going to southwestern Taiwan, it will be moving very, very slowly. So it is in an environment right now very conducive to intensification further. So we'll have lots of moisture in the area. We have warm ocean temperatures. So these can add up to Julian still perhaps increasing still its intensity by 10 kilometers per hour, maybe up to 195 kilometers per hour. But the good news is at least it is now very far, not really very far, but far from Batanes because yesterday morning, the eye wall or the area along the surrounding the eye of the typhoon. Usually the eye has calm weather, but along the eye wall, this is the area where the most violent and most destructive winds are. And the eye wall of Super Typhoon Julian actually passed Sabtang and some parts of the mainland Bataan of Batanes. So that's the reason why, as we have seen from the video shown earlier from Jack Bataliones, really very, very strong winds and very torrential rains were actually seen, almost white out or zero visibility in some of these videos.
And Ariel, Julian did not make landfall in the Philippines, but it passed very closely to extreme northern Luzon. How different would it have been if it hit landfall in the Philippines?
Well, actually, there's not much difference. The reason why is because Julian has a very wide eye, very large eye. So at some point, the entire island of Sabtang, which is the southernmost island in Batanes, was entirely enclosed in the eye. So they had calm weather for some time. But it's, as I mentioned earlier, it's the eye wall that produces the most intense and most violent winds. And the eye wall of Julian actually passed Sabtang and the mainland Bataan island of Batanes. So they still experienced the worst that, you know, they could actually get from the typhoon, regardless if it did not make landfall. So that's the reason why we have seen, you know, that much destruction, at least from the videos during the passing of the typhoon. We await the videos when, the signal perhaps is back in Batanes.
Ariel, yesterday, Pag-asa said that it is possible for Super Typhoon Julian to become or reach a signal number 5. Is it still that way today or hindi na?
Hindi na siya mangyayari because Julian already passed Batanes. So right now, even if it's a super typhoon, since Batanes is quite 204 kilometers from the center of the typhoon, it's only up to signal number 2 that's actually raised there. So the only reason Pag-asa said it is because in the event that Julian actually intensifies into a super typhoon while near Batanes, then that's the only way or the only time that they will be able to raise wind signal number 5.
And have we ever reached signal number 5 in recent years? Would you know when was the last, Ariel?
Yes, if I remember correctly, I think during Carding, I think this was in 2022, signal number 5 was raised because Carding reached super typhoon intensity. Signal number 5 was also raised during the onslaught of Raleigh in 2020. Catanduanes was under signal number 5 just before the landfall because Raleigh reached super typhoon category.
So are we still expecting tropical storms or typhoons. We actually have a few months to go before the year ends. October, November, 3 months left, Ariel.
Yes, for this last quarter, PAGASA says 4 to 7 tropical cyclones may still form or enter the Philippine area of responsibility. Now, the unique thing about, well, not really unique, but you know, it's a concerning fact about tropical cyclones during the last quarter of the year is that they landfall, they make landfall, and they cross the country. So that's the reason why we have you know, storms like Yolanda, Odette happening during the last quarter of the year. A high pressure area near Japan pushes these tropical cyclones to, you know, to go down. That's why they cross the country. They usually hit Bicol region, Eastern Visayas, and Mindanao, and they cross the country towards the West Philippine Sea. So that's the more concerning fact about tropical cyclones during the last quarter of the year. That's why we really have to be prepared.
Yeah, and are we able to at least forecast early on which parts of the Philippines these tropical cyclones most likely, at least where they may likely cross?
Yes, definitely, because of the, we have climatological maps, we know the past storms, you know, made landfall over the southern part and the central part of the country. So again, it's Bicol region, Eastern Visayas, and Caraga in Mindanao. These are the usual areas where the tropical cyclones make landfall during the last quarter of the year. They cross the country, so the other parts of the Philippines are also possible to be exposed to these tropical cyclones in the last quarter of the year.
Okay, now I know this is a bit off your expertise, but I'm curious because you are passionate about it. You're a meteorologist. I mean, we've seen it in the U.S. just recently, Helene. Tell me if I'm pronouncing it correctly, Ariel, no? But that surprised many U.S. residents based, I mean, historically speaking. Is there anything different with what the U.S. is experiencing right now? I mean, that was in Florida. They were surprised. Is it climate change or it's just really the location of the United States?
Well, definitely, there's a factor of the climate change affecting now our storms, no? As the atmosphere, you know, has increasing temperature, it becomes warmer, and then it is able to hold more moisture, and then storms tend to be able to dump more rains in the areas where they actually go. Now, with Helene, what happened is I think the residents of Florida were quite prepared, but as the hurricane went inland, as far as Tennessee, North Carolina, and Georgia, I think the residents in those areas were the ones very, very much caught by surprise. They did not expect much rain to be dumped in their areas. We have seen some warnings raised by the National Hurricane Center and some local warning agencies in the USA, and they actually were able to issue warnings, very, very timely warnings, and with proper emphasis on how much destruction will be there. But I think you know, it's always a problem, not really a problem, but a challenge for forecasters to be able to communicate well these warnings that we are issuing to the public so that they will be able to, you know, do the appropriate or the necessary actions. So I think that was the challenge that was pointed out as to why, you know, this much impact was seen in Helene in the USA.
All right. Thank you so much. As always, very informative and insightful. Ariel Rojas, ABS-CBN's resident meteorologist.
Thank you, Karen.